Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at solar power from space. So let's dive right into it. There is an inherent risk to it. It is like nuclear power, even though nuclear power is the safest source of energy we have right now, as in like the current scenario is whether you pollute the atmosphere that everyone breathes in or you pollute some landmine where you can just dump all the radioactive waste. So as I talk to you, nuclear power is the best source of electricity we have, but we don't use it because of the fear factor. Same will happen with this. So this is the biggest hurdle that we have to just get out of before this even gets off the ground. That is the first hurdle. Second hurdle is that we cannot do it from Earth. Like at best case scenario, if we like, even if BFR becomes viable, BFR is cheap enough that we can, at best case scenario, we can do what's called small scale demonstration, as in like a few gigawatts, not terawatts, few gigawatts at best case scenario. And we can only place it upwards of what's called geostationary orbit. Now that orbit has the benefit that it, like the receiver, the transmitter from the satellite will be facing one way, receiver from Earth will be facing one way. Both will be static, so that's awesome. You don't need complicated methods to, like, you know, beam the power, you know, in different directions. However, it will go through Earth's shadow at some point. Now of course it won't be in shadow for 12 hours, it will be in shadow for, depending on the trajectory and orbit and all things considered, it could be in shadow of Earth itself for roughly 2 hours to 3 hours. You have to remember, Earth is like 12,000 kilometers in terms of diameter, and the orbit, it's very large. So even though in the land you might be in dark night, it's still in the sun. So it's in sun, there will be power dip when it goes through our shadow, and then its power is going to come back. So you do realize that way we cannot have base load power, it's going to cut out. So we need gigawatt scale power storage, which is not that feasible. Even though I made a video about grid scale power here, you have to realize, like, we can't rely on that for whole country levels economy. So we have to go to the moon and we have to mine there. Moon has a lot of solar power, it has the material, so we can do it, it's doable. And where we're gonna place these solar satellites will be, the best place would be Lagrange point 5 and Lagrange point 4. The reason for those two specific points is that they never go in the shadow of Earth, so they will always be there. And these points that I'm talking about, they are very stable. Like, not all Lagrange point is very stable. Like, of course there are Lagrange point, but in some Lagrange point it's like you go a bit forward or backwards, you kind of lose orbit. It's stable in one axis but not stable in another axis. This L5 and L4 is stable in all axes, so they are the best place to place very large, I'm talking where you are getting terawatts of power, not few gigawatts, terawatts of power, very large, hundreds of kilometer large kind of structure. The best place to put them is L5 and L4. Then we come to the fact, how we're gonna make the electricity. We got the material, how we're gonna make the electricity. We cannot use solar cell flat out. We cannot use solar cell simply because solar cells work at a very narrow range of electromagnetic spectrum. Now you're already in the space, sun is already giving out energy. Why the heck you want to use something that only takes advantage of the little spectrum? Yes, our star is not very bright in X-ray and gamma ray, but it's still giving out those things, and not to mention a lot of infrared and microwave, things that we can easily reflect into some place and we can use, but our solar cell cannot use it. And not to mention all the designs that you see, things of this nature where you have a lot of mirror beaming to solar panels, those panels will require cooling, and that will be inherently very expensive system. Second, cells itself, the solar cell itself is very expensive per watt. The reason why on Earth its price is becoming closer to basically coal-fired power plant is not because the turbines are very expensive. Turbine is very cheap, like few hundred megawatt turbine is very cheap. The reason why the cost parity is even happening is because coal prices are going up. So if you are talking about, like, let's say 50 gigawatt turbine, let's say you made one giant turbine that is 50 gigawatts per watt, cost of that turbine would be nothing compared to what you need for solar cell. So not only solar cells inherently is very expensive, complicated, requires cooling, on gigawatt scale it's not even cheap. So what we're gonna actually use when we are in space, the best system is solar thermal, basically because it can use most of the electromagnetic spectrum. Heck, let's say you build the system. At first, you have aluminum foil, like, you know, acting as a mirror. You don't need polished mirror. You just need aluminum foil covered on top of a mesh to provide your concentration. Then you can make the foil thicker so it reflects more. Then you can coat it with gold, so it reflects a lot of infrared also, because sun is very bright in infrared spectrum. And the mesh behind it, you can tune it so it also reflects a microwave. So you're getting there. We can utilize a lot of energy of the electromagnetic spectrum that the sun is giving out. So that's the first advantage. Second, as I already, cost-wise, per gigawatt is cheaper. Now, in my description, I'm giving a link to a video. It's a long video, but you can watch it. The idea is very simple. If you have, you'll have cheap mirrors, expensive turbine in the center, expensive relatively speaking, not as expensive as that. And those turbine will have radiators that will be spread out, and that will cool the hydrogen. It will work on hydrogen because hydrogen transfers thermal energy into kinetic energy very effectively. It's very good for that. We also use it for rocket propellant. So, and it's not gonna catch on fire because it's in space. So for that reason, this way we can extract most amount of energy from space. So we got the energy from solar thermal power plants. Now we come to how we're gonna transmit it. We cannot use laser, few reasons. A, it's gonna cause a very serious amount of light pollution. B, if we use infrared, it's a freaking giant infrared beam that if a plane goes into it, yeah, it's dead. And not to mention birds and all that, it's very destructive. And it causes what's called blooming. Basically, this is the reason why we don't see a lot of laser-based weaponry system, because if you fire the laser for very long distance, as in like 10 kilometer or 20 kilometer, the atmosphere makes it bloom and loses a lot of energy in the matter. That's the biggest reason why we don't have laser-based ICBM interception system everywhere. Like, it can be done, but it's like to melt something that only requires 50 megawatt, you have to send like 500 megawatt just so power gets there because of the blooming factor. So for that reason, laser is flat out. And microwave is the best as I speak to you, simply because A, it's invisible to us and it's unaffected by the atmosphere. So atmosphere plays no role into it. So awesome. Then you have to understand it is very safe. So let's say you have even a very concentrated microwave beam giving the power to some place and a plane goes through it. Plane is not gonna be harmed by it. Of course, its paint might get chipped off, but anything that has a Faraday cage will be safe. And not to mention, we can spread the beam out or send it like concentrated, but by the fact of the distance, it will become spread out. So we don't have to worry about it. And to give you an idea, of course, we're gonna need large landmass if we're gonna spread, go towards the spread out idea, but you can reduce the power to 100 watts per meter square. That's safe for human consumption. That's as low as your mobile radiation, as in like next to your mobile tower. So it's safe, relatively speaking. Of course, if it goes to 200, you're gonna boil off. So you want to make sure it's below 100, but the receiver will become very big. Now again, it has very good conversion efficiency on both ends. While you are making the AC power using solar thermal, making that AC power into microwave, easy. Making that AC power back, basically microwave to your grid power, is also very efficient if you use microwave. That's conversion efficiency is very crucial, because let's say you've sent 50 gigawatt of power and you're only getting 10 gigawatt of power if you're using laser system, that remaining 40 gigawatt just became wasted heat. So you don't want that. So for that reason, microwave, as I talk to you, is the best system that we have. And not to mention, it's very cheap. The microwave receiver is like chicken wire. Yes, these can work in this. Of course, we can tune the microwave so it works very big. Or heck, we can make even a bigger mesh where the wires could be like as far apart as few meters, and it will still work. So microwave, as I talk to you, is the best way of transmitting power. Then we come to some concern, like people might have some concerns about it. And the fact that people might say, okay, we are beaming so much solar energy that's not falling on the earth, and we are like, you know, taking it from Lagrange point and then dumping it into earth. Wouldn't that heat up the planet? Short answer, no. Reason for that is that right now humanity only consumes like 20, 30 terawatts. At best case scenario, we're gonna consume 100 terawatt, but sun, as I talk to you right now, is dumping 174 petawatts of power onto sun's earth's surface. So flat out, the amount of energy we're gonna, like, even in future, even in, you know, far-flung future, it's nowhere near in the same ballpark. So flat out, not an issue. And the reason why earth is heating up is not because of our energy, is because infrared radiation that sun that's supposed to leave our atmosphere is not leaving because of CO2. It's bouncing back, so we can power these CO2 scrubbing systems. Now you might say, okay, if it was that easy, why we are not doing it? Simple reason: to drive this thing, we may end up releasing more CO2 than they can remove out. But if you are getting free power, basically the power that is not releasing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, we can use them. So this was my presentation on solar satellites, power satellites. So I hope you like this presentation and learned from it. In that case, please like. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it, and leave a comment what we're gonna see in the next episode of Future Friday. And subscribe, press the bell icon, as I make video every day. And as always, thanks for watching.